Chris Hedges wrote a book called Days of Destruction, Days of Revolt. And he goes around to the sacrifice zones of the United States. Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, where the average life expectancy for a man is 48 years old. And he goes to Camden, New Jersey, where the poverty rates are astounding.
And he makes this case that
we're facing a wholesale sacrifice of whole sectors of the population for corporate profits. And I think that's why Chris Hedges endorsed Jill Stein enthusiastically, understanding that to change this system, we have to change it at its core. It's called No More Sacrifice Zones, and it's got a sing-along part, and I'll invite you in on that. Here it is. The Army closed you in as they drove you from the plains. They said the reservation was a sacrifice zone. The Air Force took the uranium, just the fallout remains. They said the reservation was a sacrifice zone, where your story's been forgotten, we will make it known. Set for coal and uranium extraction. Every day, this designation is becoming applicable to more and more parts of the globe. The coal men blew the mountain, killing everything nearby.
They're
turning the region to a sacrifice zone. The state refuses to help your people as you watch them die. They're turning the region to a sacrifice zone, where your story's been forgotten. Where your story's been forgotten, we will make it known. We will make it known. Appalachia, you are not alone. Sacrifice continues.
Will the next one be our own?
No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. The rich make voting obsolete as they quash local control. They're turning your city a sacrifice zone. The cops occupy your street and leave a bloody toll. They're turning your city to a sacrifice zone, where your story's been forgotten. We will make it known. We will make it known. Ferguson, you are not alone. To send in the tank. tanks and drones. They're turning the next village to a sacrifice zone. Where your story's been forgotten, we will make it known. Palestine, you are not alone. If this sacrifice continues, will the next one be our own? No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. Throughout the world, men treat you as a thing to sell and own. They're turning women's bodies to a sacrifice zone. The violence you condemn, so many others will condone. They're turning women's bodies to a sacrifice zone. Where your story's been forgotten, we will make it known. Sisters. Sacrifice continues. Will the next one be our own? No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. The company picked your homeland for the pipeline to go through. They're turning the watershed to a sacrifice zone. It's been 500 years of war to take this land from you. They're turning the watershed to a sacrifice zone. Where your story's been forgotten, we will make it known. Standing Rock. Sacrifice continues. Will the next one be our own? No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones.
Thank you. And our sister Jill Stein and our brother Ajama Baraka were out there on the front lines of Standing Rock, resisting the Dakota Access Pipeline alongside the indigenous nations gathered there who are leading that struggle. Now, in this campaign, Jill has been talking a lot about the crisis. Student debt in this country. Well, I've got something to sing about that. And to help me, I'm going to use a song that was first written by Merle Travis back in 1946. This is the way that song sounded back then. You load 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. Generations, coal miners were paid not in cash, but in script. And this script was redeemable only at the company store. You see, as a worker, your life was directly controlled by your employer. Not just while you were working the mine, but when you came home for a meal. pay for it. You had to go into debt. Well, some things change and others stay the same. So I've updated this song for today's generation of 43 million debtors. Some people say you gotta get a degree. And after 4 years, you have to pay back the fees. Now I'm paying my fees out of my own. How am I ever gonna pay back the student loans? You go to 4 years of college, and what do you get? Another diploma and a mountain of debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, cause I must stay. I owe my soul to Sally Mae.
What we know as the Vietnam War. And he was a hero
of the anti-war movement at the time. Interestingly enough, Izzy Stone very much identified himself with the liberal tradition. Whereas Phil Oakes was coming out of the New Left tradition, which was really attacking the liberal tradition from the left. And somehow these two positions were coexisting within that anti-war movement. And right after Phil Oakes sang this song, Izzy Stone, he was upset. He said, "I've seen these snot-nosed Marxist-Leninists come and go, but the real work is happening down in Washington, D.C., where us liberals are trying to change things. And it's hard work doing that in Washington, D.C. And Izzy Stone was right. But so is Phil Oakes. And that's why I sing this song, although I've updated it. All the different historical references. We should go back and learn, or hear the original if you haven't. I mourned the Tiananmen martyr, whose free speech was so brutally quelled. And I cheered when Mandela walked freely after so many years in a cell. But Chelsea Manning had to face justice. And I'll gladly accept your brochure. I love Oprah and Magic and Foreman. I wish blacks were all entrepreneurs. Capitalism, they need saving. Revolution just isn't the cure. So love me, love me, love me. I'm a liberal. Disgrace America's name. Now I can't understand how their minds work. Fox News must have programmed their brains. But if you think you'll get single payer,
consider anyone's views. I watch Bill Maher and Jon Stewart. I use irony in everything I do.
Good afternoon. Today's student students are tomorrow's leaders, and I'd like to introduce to you right now Ilan from Northeastern University Socialist Group.
So my name's Ilan. As it said, I'm a student at Northeastern University. I'm a member of Socialist Alternative, and at Northeastern, we just, and a bunch of other schools around the city, we recently launched this initiative called Socialist Students, which here in Boston is a citywide initiative. We have students at several universities, a bunch of people right over here. So, and we are one of the largest student organizations in the country, actually, to be supporting Jill Stein. So I just want to talk for a minute about that. It's not always easy to support Jill Stein, as a lot of us know, right?
Facebook.
You're probably getting
berated by all your friends.
You know, saying that a vote for Jill Stein is a vote for Trump. But I think, you know, from our point of view as socialist students, what we tell people is that, you know, actually, after these elections, the right wing is going to continue to rise. Corporate politics are going to continue to grow, which helps to exacerbate Trump and Trumpism, so to speak. And so for us as socialist students, what we need to do is build left-wing politics, build anti-establishment politics that are to the left, that are pro-working class, that are pro-99%. We need to call for the things that Jill Stein's calling for and build movements, because from socialist students' perspective, movements is the way things happen. Tied to independent politics like Jill Stein, and what we think we need is a new party of the 99% that doesn't take corporate cash, that can call for things like free college, call for an end to mass incarceration, call for an end to student debt, $15 minimum wage, single-payer health care, the right of all workers to a union, things like this. And that, you know, what is needed is independent politics, a party of the 99%. We just had a debate at Northeastern. We held a debate, socialist students against the college Democrats, where 100 people came out to watch a debate on whether progressives should support Jill Stein or Hillary Clinton. And we actually got a message that the day after the debate, from a representative of the college Democrats, basically saying, he even said that she was regrettably saying this, but hey, thanks for the debate last night. A bunch of people in college Democrats reached out to me and said that after the debate, they were interested in buying some socialist students and Jill Stein merchandise. So if you could let us know when to come, that would be great. So we told them about this rally. We've been building, you know, for this rally in general, Jill Stein's campaign. And I think just to finish off, there's such an opening right now in this country for independent politics to grow, and young people especially. You know, the statistics are saying that something like 75% of young people are disgusted with this election. They think it's a joke. And I am personally one of those people, and so are we as socialist students. So if there's young people, students out here that want to get involved in building the socialist movement, building support for independent politics, definitely come check out our socialist students crew over here. We also have a socialist alternative table outside. And go Jill Stein, and let's beat this two-party system.
Before we start, just a few minutes, and remind everyone that you have a donations envelope, I hope. If you don't have one, raise your hand, and hopefully there'll be a kind volunteer to run one over to you. These envelopes help the Stein campaign build the Green Party. That's what we're going to be looking for the future, is a stronger party with good candidates like Jill Stein. So, you have your donation envelope, you'll see the information on there, your credit card information. If you're going to use a credit card, please do not use your work credit card. You fill out your name and your address. You must include your employer and your position, because the FCC wants to make sure that your employer is not funneling money for you. And if you have a check, please include it. We'll have one more slide to give you time to look through. Look through it, write a check, and if you have one ready, hold it up, and I believe Ian Jackson, treasurer of the Green Rainbow Party, will come around and elect it. And hopefully maybe that too will as well. So, one more talk, will you write out a check, and be very generous. Thank you.
I want to thank the Stein campaign, I want to thank the Green Rainbow Party for having this event and for having me here to play for you. As David said, It's very important that we raise money for this campaign right now, because this campaign is getting no money from corporations. I want to just testify here. Sometimes testifying to raising money is a thing that changes how we think about giving money. I've given nearly $200 to this campaign this season, and I just want to invite everybody who can make a contribution to please, please do so. This is a very important campaign. This next song I'm going to sing for you is a song for the Green Party in 2016. It's called The Lesser Evil and the Greater Good. It's on YouTube if you'd like to share it with your friends. There are choices in life that a person has to make, like who to spend your time with and the chances that you'll take. Come election time, the choices always seem the same. Vote for the lesser evil or refuse to play the game. When W. Bush was president, he was the worst, or so it seemed. Who predicted we'd face Donald Trump in 2016?
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon.
That doesn't sound very hopeful. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is David Gary. I am co-chair of the Green Rainbow Party, and I'll be your MC this afternoon. And I will not only be introducing our speakers, I will be reminding you to write those checks. So our first speaker tonight is my fellow co-chair, Darlene Elias. Darlene Elias has run for office in her town of Holyoke. She is also co-chair of the steering committee of the Green Party of the United States. So may I introduce to you, Darlene Elias.
They weren't surveyed, they didn't knock on their doors and ask them any questions about how
feel about this matter, and I said to myself, someone who had not known the Green Party at that time, this doesn't seem fair. This is unjust. So in my efforts to garner support and help, I started knocking on doors and asking people for help. And one of the first places I went to was the Green Rainbow Party. I went to Northampton, a regional meeting that they were having at that time, and I explained to them the dilemma. And what I remember the most about the Green Rainbow Party at that time was they didn't ask me about the fairness of it. They didn't ask me any questions about the totality of it, whether it was just or unjust. All they said to me was, how can we help, right? And I'll never forget that. 5 years later, fast forwarded another 5 years later, and just this past May, Governor Baker approved a $17 million, which has a net effect of $35 million to redevelop this apartment complex, and they broke ground just this past May. And I would say that the Green Party was very instrumental in helping me as a Puerto Rican Latina woman who grew up in the projects in the hood in South Holyoke to gain a voice, right? And to champion and advocate for my people in Holyoke who happen to be disenfranchised and marginalized and don't have any voting power because they don't hardly vote. They don't see the benefits and the advantage to that. So I want to let you know that I'm here not only because the Green Party uplifted me and empowered me, but because I do believe in the Green Party. And now they uplifted me so much that I'm the Massachusetts co-chair, right?
As you know, we're having this issue going on right now with Hillary Clinton.
It's extremely important. This isn't about winning an election. This is about building a movement. This is about changing the society, this world for a better future. And I ask you to stay with the Green Party, to join the Green Party, join the Green Rainbow Party. Join us and help us build this party, because we are the party of the future. Thank you so much.
Isn't she great? Yeah. You all wish you had a co-chair like her. I don't hear those pen scratching, folks. Let's see some donations come in. Our next speaker is from the International Socialist Organization and Justice for Palestine. I want him to speak for himself. Kerry Peterson Smith.
Here today, in a time of urgency and hope. The urgency is obvious, I think, to everybody in this room. At this moment, police and the National Guard are laying siege to the resistance at Standing Rock, continuing 500 years of settlement and colonization against the indigenous nations of this place, and securing the further destruction of our already endangered planet through another pipeline. This country's police are on a racist rampage. And just last night, the Boston Police Department killed somebody in the South End on a shaman. The climate of terror and violence for Muslims in the United States right now is a nightmare, and it corresponds to the ever-expanding wars that the United States is carrying out against Muslim countries abroad. And in an election, in which bashing immigrants has been a central feature, crimes against Asians and Latinos are also on the rise. In an election lauded as historic because a woman will likely ascend to the head of state, the actual state of women's rights in this country is a catastrophe. Whether we're talking about access to abortion, whether we're talking about the rampant sexual violence, or by any other measure. And then there are also the less discussed crises of our time. The fact that this is an unaffordable city to live in, that every city in this country is unaffordable, that there is a debt crisis, whether we're talking about student debt, housing debt, and then that there is, of course, the healthcare crisis. In this time of so many social and ecological crises, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump and the parties they represent are not solutions to these problems, nor are they irrelevant to these problems. They are part of the problem. Yeah. Among the many problems with this election, and there are many, we have a candidate who is one of the, he's running for president as part of, on the ticket of one of the two major parties, who is an open, serial, sexual predator. And it is disturbing that every Republican elected official in this country has not disavowed this and acknowledges as a disaster that their party has nominated this person, but it is also disturbing that the Democratic Party has not called for them to do so, that they give them the legitimacy to say that this is a legitimate candidate to even contend with, I think speaks volumes about what they actually think about women and women's lives. But this is not just a time of urgency, it is one, in my opinion, of hope. In an election dominated by fear, in which both parties want us to give in to our fears, we should be the hopeful ones. And I am hopeful because there is not only repression at Standing Rock, there is resistance at Standing Rock. Killings, we have not stopped mobilizing to shout that Black Lives Matter. And here locally, right across the river, dining service workers took on the richest university in the world, Harvard, and they won. So we are talking about struggles that go well beyond this election. But in this election, we do have a candidate who has been on the right side of these questions, and her name is Jill Stein. Standing Rock, Jill Stein went to Standing Rock. And I love that she took a spray can and tagged the bulldozer. And for those who are upset about her vandalizing the bulldozer, I think they should be more upset about this pipeline vandalizing the planet. On the question of Black Lives Matter, Jill Stein went to Ferguson. She's been marching and saying that Black Lives Matter. She is for universal health care, for slashing the Pentagon budget, for free education at every level, and the list could go on. So I want to thank Jill Stein for actually giving us a ticket to support in this election. Also, but I gotta say also, here in Massachusetts, no one too, obviously, okay? But I also want to say that the fight continues, and we have to talk about the electoral system itself. Now, there are many people on the left, progressives, who will be voting green for the first time, breaking with the Democratic Party for the first time this year, which is fantastic. And I want to challenge you to not only break with the Democrats this year, but forever.
Station, but please fill out those checks and your donation. envelopes. So our next speaker is Danny Factor, who is currently running as a Green Rainbow Party candidate for the 14th Middlesex District. And he's been a very active person in this town of Acton and at the Green Rainbow Party. Danny Factor.
Hello, everybody. So my name is Danny Factor. I'm the Green Rainbow Party candidate for state representative in the 14th Middlesex District, which includes the town of Concord, it includes the town of Carlisle, and parts of the town of Acton and Chelmsford. And I really want to be honest with you. There's a part of me that doesn't want to speak at all because I really want to hear Jill. But as tempted as I am to just introduce Jill, we in the Green Rainbow Party don't start with the top billing first. We have something called our 10 key values. And one of the 10 key values is called decentralization. And the idea is that decision making should, as much as possible, remain not at the top, but at the individual and local level. And while assuring that all civil rights are protected for all citizens, you know, the goal of our party is to be a grassroots party and to create change by running as many local candidates as possible, with the idea that change grows from the bottom up, democratically, not imposed from the top down. So when I listen to my sister Jill, and I still can't wait to hear her, I want you to consider imagining something when you hear her speak, which is whether Jill will be talking about climate change, or ending poverty, or creating peace, or racial justice. Imagine what change might be, not only in our world, not only in our nation, not only in the state that you live in, but in your city, or your town, or your neighborhood, or the school that you go to, or your workplace, or your street, or with your family and friends. And finally, imagine how what Jill says today might just change you. See, I'm running for local office, I can tell you, because of a core value that I think we all share, which is that every single person deserves dignity, respect, and love. And when we say everybody, we really mean everybody, regardless of race, regardless of gender, regardless of age, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of religion, regardless of nationality, regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of gender identity, regardless of whether one has a physical or mental disability, regardless of whether one's immigration status is documented or undocumented, and regardless of whether somebody is a prisoner or free, every single person matters. So, I suggest when you hear Jill speak about halting climate change or ending poverty by the year 2030, think about when she talks about this Green New Deal, what would a Green New Deal look like in Dorchester, or in Somerville, or in Brockton, or in Pittsfield, or in Northampton, or in Fall River, or in Worcester, or in Framingham, or in Lynn? When we say a ban on all new fossil fuel infrastructure, what would it look like if we got a local coalition of people and we stopped a $1 billion company like Kinder Morgan to shelve a pipeline project going the length of the state. Wait a second, we already did that. So if we can do that, we can stop the Spectra pipeline in West Rochester too. It might take more local chapters, it might take more local organizing, it might take continued civil disobedience, and it might also take electing members of the Boston City Council and to the State House that actually have teeth. And if we're really interested in ending fossil fuel infrastructure in Massachusetts, what would it look like on the local level? What if, at your local board of selectmen, when a permit came up to connect a gas line to a new house, what if there were two Greens on the board of selectmen that said, you know what, we don't have to grant that permit. We can connect the heat pump to the new house, connect the heat pump to an electronic grid. We can fuel the grid by solar and wind, and we can have this new house fueled with 100% renewable energy. And what if the Green Rainbow Party had one, even one representative in the State House? Because I'll tell you, if we did, that representative would not just be representing their district, they would be representing all the people who are disenfranchised now in the state of Massachusetts. And what if they started talking about climate change, not only from the point of view of the threat in Massachusetts to our coasts, but what if they started talking about the threat of climate change to our food supply, and mentioned that we are risking statewide a collapse of our food supply, and that the people most disproportionately affected will be the people who are already vulnerable, such as people of color, people with disabilities, and people of little income. What if our Green Rainbow Party state representative and state senator said something like that? And if you guys know anything about your city and town governments, imagine if your economic development committee and your finance committees were actually interested in the finances of average people. What if a Green Rainbow Party member of a town finance committee actually got up in front of town meeting and said that the chief goal of the finance committee is now to make sure that every person, regardless of their income, has an economic human right to healthy food, clean water, single-payer health care, and accessible housing, meaning that if you have a disability, you should not have to wait 10 years to get an apartment that will allow you to use the bathroom, or one that if you don't have, you will die on the streets and sleeping in your car. What if we had finance committee members like that? And when it comes to democracy, what if more towns adopted what the city of Cambridge is already doing when it talks about ranked choice voting? And what if the use of ranked choice voting spread so widely from town to town that people were less scared to vote for the Green Rainbow Party candidates? And what if it resulted, what if it actually resulted in the ranked choice voting bill getting out of the state legislature where it's been stuck for 10 years? So what I'm saying is that when we talk about the 10 key values of the Green Rainbow Party, grassroots democracy, ecological wisdom, social justice, equal opportunity, nonviolence, community-based economics, feminism, respect for diversity, personal and global responsibility, future focus, and sustainability. We also talk about decentralization, because I'm very, very glad to hear Jill today candidates that we will have and that we need to really make the difference. So thank you very much, and think about what you can do on your own local level to either run as a candidate, to join a town committee. So many of them are actually ones that have openings that you can volunteer on. Make a difference in your town, and then vote for Jill Stein and Jamu Baraka for president. Thank you very much.
Bribes pouring into the two corporate parties, often from the same tiny club of billionaires giving to both candidates. It is about the hands of the wealthy 1% manipulating the strings on the puppets that we call our government, while telling us, pay no attention to the people behind the curtain. The same money and the same backroom deals are making the candidates dance. The same corporate masters hold a death grip on the so-called debates. I'm sorry, did I say debates? They were nothing but another scripted reality show with two chosen actors delivering lie after lie to scare the people into voting. They're trying to frighten people into voting against our own best interests. The same plutocrats who drove us into our second Great Depression continue to steal homes from ordinary Americans through illegal foreclosures, including over 70,000 in our state, and continue to form fewer and fewer giant monopolies, gambling with the wealth that should belong to us. Well, Houston, Washington, and Boston, we, the Green Party of the United States, have a solution. We are the only party to refuse corporate lobbyist money, refuse super PAC money, and refuse to accept the rule of the men and a few women behind the money curtain. Greens are actively working to get big money out of elections and out of government by gathering signatures to put a state amendment on the ballot. This amendment, called We the People, clearly states corporations are not people and may be regulated. It declares money is not speech. This amendment could help clean up our state house, municipal, and local government elections. The Lowell Sun reported in 2013, lobbying was already a $100 million a year industry, flooding the state house with corporate and deep pocket influence, drowning out the voices of the vast majority. This money comes, as often as not, from out-of-state donors, like the Walton family of Walmart, who frankly have no interest in the concept of democracy, of letting Massachusetts residents decide what's good for us. We could stem that flood and the flood of money into the campaign coffers of incumbents, such as my opponent, Harold Naughton, who is elected to represent a generally low-earning, low-wealth district. Somehow, he has raised over $900,000 for his campaign account since 2002. Roughly $260,000 of that money comes from donors who did not report their occupation or employer. What could that money possibly be for? Gold-plated yard signs? Turns out the Lowell Sun found evidence that the money our legislators are receiving is often spent to stop legislation from being passed. And that money as muzzle technique works. It was reported on WVUR that almost no legislation of any significance was passed in the most recent legislative session on Beacon Hill. The amendment that Greens support could give Massachusetts a chance to again pass laws that protect and improve the lives of the 99%. It could help us create living wage laws and a graduated income tax, make corporations pay their fair share of taxes, establish paid family and medical leave, get us true health care for all, abolish mass incarceration, stop predatory lending, reverse illegal foreclosures, fully fund public education, and so much more. Our presidential candidate by telling you about a Central Mass resident a teacher active on global warming issues. We are both members of 350 Central Mass, which educates and organizes people to respond to our climate crisis. My friend, we'll call him Bruce because that's his name, told me, "I'm voting for Jill Stein in 2016, and let me tell you why." Like many of us, Bruce has been following the efforts of Native people living on reservations in North Dakota to halt the building of the Dakota Pipeline through their ancestral Native sacred lands. Jill Stein, while visiting the protest site to stand in solidarity with the Native leaders blocking pipeline construction, was photographed spray painting her opposition on the blade of a bulldozer. When I saw the photo of her writing, "I approve this message" on that bulldozer, woo! I knew she was my candidate. Woo! Good people, I present to you Dr. Jill Stein, candidate for the highest elected office of the land, the office of President of the United States of America.
Thank you.
So this is a very exciting development to see. But most exciting, I have to say, is to see this political revival here. Because if we are only social movements, then we are played off against each other, and it continues to be a game of divide and conquer. It took me decades as an activist to learn the reason why we must all also be political activists. We must take the fight not only to the front lines of the pipelines, to our campuses, to fight for free public higher education, and to end student debt, we are fighting for immigrant rights as human rights. We must fight all of these fights. But if we only fight on the front lines, and we don't also fight in the halls of power and in the voting booth, then all our efforts are really for naught and will be canceled out with the flick of a pen and the legislation that destroys our movements. So I'm just so excited to see the building of a real political movement in the form of the Green Party. Thank you all. I especially want to thank all those who've been here for so many years building the Green Party so that we would have this infrastructure when people were finally ready for it. Would you please just quickly stand up if you've been a part of building the Green Party? Thank you so much. Thank you all so much. And would you please stand up if you are part of this new infusion of energy and passion that's coming from the Bernie campaign, which has been such a wonderful justice. Thank you so much. So together we really are burning green, and there is no going back. I feel like we have crossed the Rubicon in the course of this election, and there is so much farther we can go, but we've actually transformed this fight by merging as the Bernie campaign into the Green Party. We are an unstoppable coalition. Thank you so much. I guess what I want to say today, more than anything else, is to just affirm how much power we do have. If we had access to the airwaves, there is little doubt that we could be winning this election. This is like, you know, when just when you think the election could not get any slimier, any more corrupt and outrageous, you know, you just like open the newspaper, or you turn on your news source, whatever that is, and there is no end to this bottomless toilet that this campaign seems to be contained by. And, you know, even before these recent revelations, Donald Trump as the sexual predator, Hillary Clinton as the queen of corruption, even before that news came out, you know, these were the two most untrusted and disliked candidates ever in American presidential history. Even the supporters of Donald Trump don't really support Donald Trump. They're mainly afraid of Hillary Clinton. And the same has been true for most of the campaign, at least. I haven't seen the latest polls, but most of Hillary's supporters have come into her camp, not because they like her or trust her, but because they can't stand Donald Trump. And we are the well-kept secret, the only campaign in this election that is not poisoned by corporate money, by lobbyist money, and by a super PAC. And we do not take marching orders from the predatory banks, from the fossil fuel giants, from the war profiteers and the insurance companies. So my running mate, Ajamu Baraka, and I have the sole liberty in this campaign to stand up for what it is that the American people are clamoring for what we urgently need, and for what actually is within our reach. And, you know, I think my message to you today is to just be, you know, be of confidence, and be of incredible, be reassured how much support there is for what we represent, for a real politics of integrity, but for the real solutions that we alone are standing up for. And just to drive this home, on one issue alone, we could win this election right now if word got out. And basically, it's 72% of the American public that doesn't know that they have another choice, aside from these two horrible candidates, these two evils that people are told they have no option from. Most people are clamoring for that other option. It's 57% of voters who just said a couple weeks ago they are dying for another independent political party. And right now, those two parties have basically merged into one party, because the Republicans have fallen apart, the Democrats have split with the Democrats of Integrity from the Bernie campaign merging with the Greens. Meanwhile, the Democrats and Republicans have basically gotten together as one big, happy, corporate political party. So, you know, they can have each other, but the American people is dying for another option. We are that option. So, you know, you just see this, it's all over the place. The writing is on the wall that people are desperate for what it is that we represent. And it's only a matter of time, because that house of cards is falling down. As the famous philosopher Woody Allen said, half of life is showing up. You want to be there as that house of cards comes down. It is coming down. It's not a question of if, it's just a question of when. And we are here. So let me just say one of the places where we have that power, and that is on the issue of predatory student loan debt. Because right now, there are 43 million young people and not so young people who are trapped in student debt. Because once you get in, you don't get out. Not in the economy that we have, this low-wage, part-time, temporary job economy, from which there is no escape from student debt. So that number keeps getting bigger every year. It's now 43 million at last count. It's probably bigger than that by now. But it turns out there's only one place for those votes to go, because there's only one campaign that will bail out the students. You're looking at that campaign right now. And we bailed out the crooks on Wall Street who crashed the economy. It's about time we bailed out the victims of that wasteful. And by the way, this isn't just something to do for that younger generation. This is something we have to do for us all. Because who is it
that leads the way forward on social transformation, whether it's for labor rights, whether it's for climate justice, whether it's for Black Lives Matter, whether it's for immigrant rights and the Dreamers campaign. It's always been the younger generation that leads the way forward on those struggles. So it's really critical for all of us, if we're going to move forward, that we need to liberate the real engine of social change, the young people who are trapped in debt right now. And remember, this is not like some, you know, useless giveaway. This is the stimulus package of our dreams. Because you got 43 million people who are already trained up. They have their degrees, they've got, you know, they've got the training, they have the talent, they have the passion and the vision. They are ready to go. We just need to unleash them and let them get to work, reviving our economy and creating the communities of the future that they have in their mind's eye. People with my hair color tend to see the world the way it's been, but people with a different hair color see the world the way it's going. So you need to be liberated to lead the way forward. Solutions. Because if word gets out that young people, millennials, could come out and take over this election, it turns out 43 million people locked in debt is a winning plurality of the vote. You guys could be the October surprise. You could be the November surprise. This issue as a critical issue that can never be ignored again. We put it on the map, and we are not going away, by the way. We are here to stay, to keep fighting on this. And we could not only win this if 43 million people got word that they could cancel that debt effectively by coming out and voting green. We can not only cancel the debt, we can make public higher education free. It pays for itself. We know that, 7-1. So we can't afford not to do it. We could create an emergency jobs program that also solves the emergency of climate change in a Green New Deal, like the New Deal that got us out of the Great Depression, but it's also a green one to get us out of this climate crisis. And I know I'm getting the time signal here because I got a plane to catch, but let me just run through a couple other ones real quick. We call for 100% clean renewable energy by 2030. So this is a win for our economy, it's a win for our climate, it's a win because it makes the friggin' wars for oil obsolete. are not making us safer, they are making us less safe. They are creating failed states, mass migrations, and worse terrorist threats. We call for a new offensive in the Middle East. It's called a peace offensive. And it starts with a weapons embargo. Since we are supplying the majority of weapons to all sides, this is an easy thing for us to begin. We also call for a freezing of the bank accounts of those countries that continue to fund terrorist enterprises, in particular our allies, Saudi Arabia. and to bring to bear on this not only our stories, but also our music and our art, so that we can discover, rediscover, and reaffirm our common humanity, in which we are one human family on one small boat. We will all sink together or sail together. Let's make it sail together.
Propaganda of the lesser evil, and fight
be quick, because we really do have to get to the airport.
Time for a selfie!